more and more walls are being created between countries, between also the science community. And that's something which I'm worried about. Mm-hmm.
Nobody can contain the virus alone. Nobody can fight climate change in their corner of the world.
We should also talk a little bit about scientific sanctions. Do we see this as a kind of anti-science diplomacy or negative science diplomacy?
The first thing we need to discuss and I think agree on is what is actually science diplomacy. This has been a term that has been growing in relevance and trending for the last 10 years or so. But still we have a bit of confusion about what actually means. When I look back at my own career, going from a scientist in the lab doing molecular biology to working in the international multilateral system, I realized that this journey and this connection between the worlds of science and diplomacy is very rare, considering that all of the challenges that we face today have scientific dimensions, require global cooperation. No country can solve them alone. Climate change, pandemics, as we have seen in recent years.
From my point of view, when I've been working on the science diplomacy, when I was at the European Commission and in the field of science innovation, dealing with a lot of different countries, it's very much using cooperation between scientists across borders to create partnerships and bridges and confidence between countries.
For me, basically, it is about mobilizing science for goals of international governance. That were two normative views on the relation between science and those who fund science and those who want to use the results of scientific research. One normative view is that it's all about the interest, the personal interest of the states or the companies that finance research, because if you're paying for it, then it's normal to accept that you also have the benefits of it. Mm-hmm. But there is a second normative view that is stressing the idea that science should also serve the commons of a society.
Especially in these times of erosion of public trust in both science on the one hand, but also in political institutions and our political system. And we have obviously been made aware of this problem with the COVID pandemic, right, in terms of lack of cooperation, but also lack of trust in science, communication, and trust in institutions. How can science diplomacy help address that?
We see at the moment already for a couple of years the breakdown of the multilateral system, of all the rules of engagement which we had defined together, are not functioning anymore as they used to. So new tools need to be developed for countries to work together. And science diplomacy has to be deployed more than ever before as a tool to create those interactions which at the moment are so difficult given geopolitical tensions and given the fact that the multilateral system is breaking down.
But on the other hand, we should not be naive. And I don't think that necessarily because we have scientists of different parties, different countries talking to each other, that it will help solving conflicts. For me, the main issue is on the one hand, evidence-based facts that we have to collect and bring to the policymakers' tables. And on the other hand, make sure that the different parties can enter into a dialogue with each other.
Could you expand a little bit on this naivety? Because I think it's important that we address that topic as well.
I think that the naivete of some scientists is that they think, oh yes, if we can talk to each other, that will solve the world problems. One of the things that is needed is that you foster the dialogue, that you create schemes of talking to each other on the basis of openness, that you're willing to share your data, that you're willing to share your results with the other parties. And that is, of course, the whole crucial issue. Do we want to do that? Do we want to make open science as a kind of general model for global science on the level of the whole planet? Or do we say, well, there are limits to that openness. We need to be closed in some circumstances.
So I would like to focus now a little bit on the conditions for science diplomacy to be successful. We know it takes trust, it takes mutual understanding, transparency. What are other, say, conditio sine qua non to make science diplomacy effective and successful?
So I think, first of all, scientific excellence is very important. There has been some concern sometimes from scientists that science diplomacy can be, or perhaps a mistaken perception, that science diplomacy can be a way to politicize science, or they can feel instrumentalized. So I think we have to be very clear that any international scientific project comes on the basis of excellence first and foremost. Then the question of capacity building. So if we put a scientist and a diplomat together without any sort of training or just awareness of how the other world functions, it will be very difficult and it will take a long time to arrive to this, to an effective
kind of
dialogue.
A detachment from scientists in foreign affairs, for instance, in the diplomatic scene. I think the United States have such a system, right, where scientists are entering, say, the Foreign Office.
Exactly.
An interesting one, the role of universities. We have had now, I'm at the Eindhoven University of Technology, as you know, all engineers we train, mm-hmm. and they all go into the high-tech industry. And we have big recruitment fairs where companies come on campus to recruit our research. We have now, for the first time, had a little representation of the Dutch Ministry of Foreign Affairs mm-hmm. trying to recruit engineers.
Exactly, that's exactly
what we need. In order to not have just the lawyers,
right.
political scientists in the Foreign Office.
But there is something else. Next to capacity, you also need to create willingness with the scientists to act as such. There was still quite a lot of scientists who say, give me the money, let me do my thing, mm-hmm. I publish, and that's it.
Right. This is fascinating. When you look at the rules for entering the Foreign Service in many countries, mm-hmm. you actually find that only 2 or 3 degrees, backgrounds, are allowed to even apply. Now a lot of countries are changing, and this has to go through parliament, so it's not trivial. They are changing the rules to allow scientists and engineers to enter the Foreign Service. And then on the question of universities, so in Switzerland, actually, there are very exciting developments. University of Geneva and the ETH Zurich have created the Science in Diplomacy Lab, developing new methods, new diplomatic methods. For example, computational diplomacy, negotiation engineering. So those are new methodologies using machine learning and artificial intelligence to optimize and sometimes depoliticize negotiations.
So then, science diplomacy becomes a topic of academic study,
right.
of scholarship, which is also, I think, relatively new.
Exactly.
And that's, Luc, you're doing already for quite a number of years, some work on that.
Eh? Yes.
To really, you know, look at science diplomacy from an academic angle, methodologies, procedures,
right.
Trends.
We also sometimes focus on the issues of today, and we don't anticipate what the scientific and technological issues of the future are going to be that require this governance and these diplomatic frameworks. And then always technology moves faster than policy, and then we're always reacting to it. So thinking about questions like gene editing, questions like geoengineering, decarbonization materials, neurotechnologies, all of these almost science fiction topics are going to be reality very soon. And then that brings into question all of these traditional models of large scientific infrastructures that are based on diplomatic agreements. And many of them born in the Cold War, when we had really big political tensions, but still we managed to build and agree on certain governance frameworks, for example, for Antarctica, for addressing the hole in the ozone layer. Do we need a new model for these types of large international infrastructure?
So whether it's a physical project like CERN mm-hmm. or the International Space Station, or it's a kind of a more virtual project by sharing data and doing things in a different way, I think there always needs to be a project for people to put their teeth in, joining forces with the idea of changing the world.
I totally agree with that. You need projects to mobilize the diplomatic world, especially, and then the scientific world as well. And projects have it creates a community feeling, and that is very important.
The war has been a reality check for Absolutely. Science diplomacy. And the limits of science diplomacy.
No, it's indeed. Science diplomacy is, I would not call it a drop in the ocean. It's an important tool, but we should not, of course, overestimate its role.
On the other hand, whatever conflicts we have on planet Earth, geopolitically, we have common enemies that should bring us together. And one of the main common enemies at this moment is climate change.
Mm-hmm. I think it's hard for us as humanity to recognize and unite against that common enemy, climate change, also COVID-19, right? We still look for another to blame, to retaliate against. Is it the question of recognizing the global interconnectedness and that we cannot solve one issue if we don't work with everyone else, right? Nobody can contain the virus alone. Nobody can fight climate change in their corner of the world without help from the other countries. So this sounds like a very basic principle, but I think we're still far from grasping it as a species, really, in a higher sense.
Well, what is worrying me is that the whole notion of technological sovereignty is becoming a problem in the sense that it limits the openness of science.
I think Europe has been forced to develop a policy of technological sovereignty. Europe was always believing in a multilateral system, a global multilateral system based on sharing, on a win-win situation and cooperation. But Europe has seen at the same time that there has been a complete change in the world, in world politics and geopolitical situation, very much a strong China first policy, an America first policy. So Europe, I think Europe has been naive, and that's why I think the European agenda of technological sovereignty, for instance, in the field of semiconductors, chips manufacturing, bringing it from 8% now for the world market to 20% by 2000 is a very good one, mm-hmm. because we cannot have trust anymore in this multilateral system. We need to restore it through mm-hmm. science diplomacy mm-hmm. and other tools. At the moment, it's difficult though. I'm now in a university, and I see that in many universities, of course, the governments are trying to restrict exchanges of staff, mm-hmm. of researchers, of students even. So it used to be a very open system across mm-hmm. the globe, with students from China, from India, from all over the world, coming together at different universities. At the moment, more and more being hampered for very good reasons, for political reasons, but we see that that is of course very much hampering science cooperation taking place and science diplomacy of being deployed. Mm-hmm. More and more walls are being created between countries, between also the science community, and that's something which I'm worried about.
Mm-hmm. The scientific community really sees itself as one, right? Yeah. And not divided by country or by nationality or by backgrounds or other features, and that's the power of science in providing this perhaps more neutral space of engagement than and that is less charged politically, ideologically, because the laws of physics are the same all over the world, and I like to say that 2 + 2 = 4 in South Africa and in Brazil and in Canada, and that is a very powerful tool for engagement when all the other issues are contested or more difficult to engage on.
Well, I think first of all a matter of recognizing each other, the diplomats recognizing the power of scientists and the scientists recognizing that they are not politicians and not the diplomats.
Perhaps we need to update our systems and our structures for how science flows into policy making, right? So we have the example of the IPCC, the climate scientists that provide every few years the latest assessments on climate science, and that feeds the negotiations at COP, as we all know. And this is a very, very well-recognized model. And many other fields of science and many other global issues try to build IPCC for this and that, right?
You just mentioned how can we enlarge it, how can we do better? I think the main challenge at the moment is how to preserve it. How can we preserve the cooperation we have in ITER, thermonuclear mm-hmm. fusion reactor, which is being built in Cadarache in France, with partners from all over the world. How can we preserve the International Space Station? I think the challenge is at the moment to really value and recognize these important vehicles we have. We have CERN as well, with the Square Kilometer Array. Yeah. Let's make sure that what we have, which functions so well, is preserved.
We should also talk a little bit about scientific sanctions, used as an instrument to influence geopolitics. Do we see this as a kind of anti-science diplomacy or negative science diplomacy?
It's a very complex issue. I think the maintaining of the ties people to people, scientist to scientist, is something that should always be preserved in general. I remember when I was working in the US at the American Association for the Advancement of Science, I was managing a project, scientific cooperation between the United States and Cuba, which had no diplomatic relations for over 50 years and a very strong embargo and sanctions. And the fact that the scientific ties among the researchers were maintained, even in the lowest point in the political relationship, that allowed, after the diplomatic relations were reestablished, a very quick coming back to address common issues.
I think it's therefore good that our governments, at European level as well, have said, you know, block, freeze all institutional cooperation with universities and research institutes. At the personal level, cooperation is still happening and also encouraged. But the institutional cooperation, I think, is rightly so being put on ice with regard to the Russian Federation.
Indeed, with sanctions in general, there is a kind of moral dilemma. That is that on the one hand, you want sanctions to hurt. But in the case of science, I think, there is another dimension that is important. That is that we have a number of international collaborations around global challenges, around global problems, that need the attention of all the different states involved, of all the scientific communities.
How can we arrive to a global consensus on climate action, for example, or a new pandemic treaty that WHO is negotiating right now, if the member states have voted and we require everyone at the table to address a global challenge, and we cannot do it without one or more of those countries participating?
It will be good if ultimately, you know, ties could be restored, mm-hmm. And let's hope that this illegal war would come to an end quite quickly.